This afternoon, we are interviewing General Tindi Sharma, as he is lovingly and admiringly known in Bombay circles. This particular interview is for the bicentennial celebrations, which is going to take place from 29th January to 1st February at Pune. General Sharma has a long inning in Bombay circles, and therefore we request him to tell his story right from his earlier days to now.
Well, I have this to say, that I'm one of the few who've been in all the three sappers. I began as a Madras sapper, 1944, as a cadet, got commissioned there, served with Pathans as a Bengal sapper, 1945-46, 47 I came back from Pakistan and found myself posted to 20 Field Company of Bombay Sappers, whom I'd known earlier in Indonesia, known them very well. And as a very lucky person, ever since November 1947, I've been a Bombay Sapper. As a very unlucky person, the only service I've actually done in Bombay Sappers is adjutant of the training battalion in 1948 for a few months. And I got posted off to a selection board as one of the group testing officers. Fortunately, came back to Bombay Sappers, adjutant of the training battalion again in 1950 when Prem Bhagat was commandant. And very regrettably, had to get off to the CME to do a engineering course, what they had the supplementary course in those days for serving officers. And I remained a Bombay sapper ever since, but never again served in the center, which I think is very, very unfair, because it's such a wonderful place, the center in Bombay sappers. Well, jaise Pathan kehte the, jo kismat pe likha hai, wo zarur hona, that is exactly that. As time passed, I became Colonel Commandant of the Bombay Sappers. Without ever physically having served there since 1950. And when I retired, I was still Colonel Commandant of the Bombay Sappers, which was a wonderful experience, because I found Bombay Sappers the most relaxed, comfortable, couldn't care less bunch of all the sappers. I'm the only survivor of British days where they said sappers are mad, married or Methodists. I'm not quite sure what Bombay sappers are. They're certainly mad. I'm not sure how many are married. And as far as religion concerns, God help anybody who goes near them. But they couldn't care a damn about anyone or anything. Far better than all the others. And Bombay sappers has grown from those early days where they suffered the most in partition in 1947, because they had the largest number of British officers, Royal Engineers, who left us in 47. And sheer chance it was. They had a mess that they owned themselves, which they started building in 1905 out of officers' money, on old grant land, where the rent was 1 rupee a month, I think, or something like that. We still own that mess. So there are a lot of stories about Bombay sappers that have gone on. After independence, all the messes, many were owned by the regiments, wherever they were given to the MES. The MES took it over. And I can tell you about this Bombay sappers, that I was the colonel commandant there. And the order came that you will give it to the MES. So I was a major general at that time in Delhi. And at the headquarters, the army headquarters, I said, yes, if it's an order, I have to obey it. So the QMG said yes. QMG was a friend of mine, mind you. So I said, but I'm not going to give it to you unless you pay us for it. He said, no, the MES have valued it. The cantonment lands have valued it, they fixed this value. I said, no, the value is very much more. So he said, how do you work it out? I said, we got two chartered accountants and builders and architects from Bombay, individuals separately, to value the mess, and the value is so much. So in that group sitting there in front of the QMJ, one of the other major generals said, it's an order that you will obey. So I said, the order is fully obeyed as a serving major general, but as one of the owners of Bombay Sappers, I am going to run a case against you, one of the owners, that you have not paid us the compensation. We are the only mess owned by us surviving, and we want to remain the same unless you pay us the compensation. And it is so much. So the lands and hirings person said, no, that's far too much. It's much cheaper to leave it with them. I said, make up your minds. So they said, no, it's an order you will obey. I said, as a serving Major General Bay, as an owner, I'll file the case against you as head of the Bombay Sapper Owners. And there was such a fuss there. And they said, you obey orders. I said, to hell with you. Of course I'm obeying orders. They said, tell me what I've disobeyed. So this is one of the strange things about Bombay Sappers. Today in our country, we are the only regiment in the whole country that still owns its own mess, which in British days was a routine thing for many, many people to own it.
Well, thank you, sir.
That's the answer.
Wonderful argument. And thank you for keeping the Bombay Sappers mess with us by winning this argument. So will you tell me something? We heard something about your Kathmandu experience, that you were flown as 411.
Yes, that's a very unusual one. That this was 1952, we were out in the fields in 1951 opposing then Pakistan, and the parachute brigade was facing what is East Pakistan in those days, now Bangladesh. And 411 was out in a place called Barasat, very lonely then, little outside
West Bengal, sir.
In West Bengal, about 30-40 kilometers outside Calcutta. And we came back to Ranchi, where we were out there. And suddenly the order came, go and build the airfield at Kathmandu. And we're sending an airplane in 4 days to Ranchi airfield, at the quarter, Air Force Guard will fly you up there. Take a team of half a dozen people at least to help you to plan it. So I said, I asked the chief engineer, who was then Brigadier Sarapa, who later on became engineer-in-chief as a major general. So I said, any details of it? He said, no. Any plan of it? He said, no. I said, any layout, anything, any map, any bloody thing? He says, there's no bloody thing, just go there and build it. I said, okay. So I said, how do I do it? He said, I'll give you an impress of 7 lakhs, you can spend it there. So 4 days later, we were at Ranchi airfield, and a young captain came hanging his head in shame, saying, sorry sir, the impress is not signed, the brigade is out on tour. So I said, you mean I go and build it without impress? He said, yes. I said, okay, go. Paratroopers are mad. I took about 100, I took my thing and the rest, about 120 paratroopers marched in. The rest we had to leave behind in India because we couldn't take transport, we couldn't take anything. We just went with their personal weapons and landed there. And we received a great welcome. And the biggest welcome was from a Major General Pranjpe, paratrooper, whom I knew earlier since early 1947, when he came to do his para jumps as a, Sanders Commission Lieutenant Colonel, about to become a brigadier, to command a parachute brigade, and showed him around the place at that time in Chiklala, Rawalpindi. And we were good friends. So went up to him and said, I got this job. So he said, yeah, we need to do that thing. I said, but I got no money, I got nothing. So he took me to the Prime Minister of Nepal, who was MP Koirala at that time. So we sat in front of MP. And MP said, no, I must have it. I said, I've got no money, nothing. I've got 120 paratroopers, all workers. I need about 2,000 people. He said, hire anybody, we'll pay for it. So I said, oh, and I need certain equipment and certain things because you're going to build it like the build the pyramids by hand. But whatever equipment you've got, road rollers, anything, they had 2-3 road rollers, steam and operated there, no other machines. I said, we'll do it. So he said, yes, but I said, do you need money to pay those people? He said, I'll pay the money. I said, I can't handle money. I don't know how to do it. We had never done it. So he gave me an engineer officer from the Nepal engineers, came with us. Very wise old man, highly experienced, risen from the bottom, and he served with us. He kept all the records, he paid all the money, we never touched anything. And we built this damned airfield in 8 weeks, mostly by hand, a lot of improvised things. We had these two steam rollers operated with coal. We were burning wood in it to help us consolidate it with the lowest of low specifications. We had a thing called PBS, which is bitumen fabric, fabric, which we had used during the Second World War. Where in some airfields I had seen in the Second World War, we put five layers on top. But our wonderful government of those days, Government of India, I think they expected us to fail, said, we'll give you enough for one. One layer all over. So I said, one layer will never survive. And then you wanted something to seal it, they never gave us any sealant. But as the roads kept coming up, I had some very good officers. There was a Captain Govinder Singh, who ultimately retired as one of the chief engineers, equal to a lieutenant general in airfield construction and PWD. There was C.B. Rajaram, great artist, wild paratrooper, Shivraj Kishore, sort of honor from IMA, second lieutenant there. Four officers like that, and a doctor, Captain Ghosh, who was supposed to look after us, who belonged to 60 Parafield Ambulance, wild as they come, who ultimately retired as a major general. So there was I with these totally bachelor team, trying to keep them under control in Nepal. And we worked day and night, without a break, in shifts, because that was the only way of getting the job done.
Great, sir.
And the day drained, when you couldn't work because the earth was soft, you didn't have, we'd take a break, and the whole company and everybody disappeared. And we had 2,000 Nepalese labor, 99% of them girls. And to keep law and order, they gave me 200 Nepalese
police,
policemen, very nice people, and of course a Nepalese field company of about 260, commanded by a major, very thing. And when we broke off and had a ball, we all broke off and had a ball. Nobody was there except to keep guard. We had a wonderful time and we got the job done. And I think mad people are lucky, because those days we had some early pre-monsoon showers, which when we used to take the breaks. It was 24 hours a day. If it rained, 12 hours, 24 hours off till the earth dried a bit. We had no other means of handling it. And weather was kind. We got 2 weeks extra. We finished it.
Commendable, sir. Commendable.
I'm not sure. Commendable. Good luck. If you think I did any work on it, I didn't. Govinder Singh handled all the work with the field and organizing it. Shivraj Kishore handled half the airfield. Rajaram handled the other half. I was totally unable to supervise it because there were a lot of politics attached to this. So I stood outside the airfield and did it, and I kept yelling for more bitumen, for more this, I mean bitumen rolls, this prefabricated bitumen sheets with hessian with bitumen on both sides you're using. So we kept getting more and more and more as it came, and as the monsoon started, we started repairing everything and doubling it. Ultimately, in the center of the airstrip, we had about four layers of bitumen, and on the edges we still had one, but we built drains on both sides and the drains overflowed. And we had another point that the water flowing through earth would erode it because it's a plateau. So then we had to dam the drains in part so the erosion would be stopped there. And I don't know about everyone else, but we were certainly surprised that the job got done. So tell me one thing, you've been Gun Commandant.
Bombay
Sappers, yes.
So any particular story or anecdote or any particular incident which flashes back in your mind about that period?
Well, I was in Bombay Sappers when somebody got shot up while they were hunting for birds near the ranges at Diggy Ranges.
Yes.
And they were shooting birds and somebody got drowned when rescuing a bird and they brought him back. He was a Maratha. And there was a Jamadar Sahib, Naib Subedar as he called now, Sikh who was there with him, and he came back. And Colonel Bhagat was the commandant, and we all had gone off to Lonavala and Khandala and down below trying to shoot duck and birds and deer over there, and pigs really, because Dukkar, as the Marathas called it, wild boar would damage the crops there. So they asked him, sent somebody to kill the wild boar. They were welcomed everywhere. So we were all out there. And then I had a motorcycle of my own, 350cc, twin cylinder, 1939 model, the love of my heart, Triumph. And I rode it back there, and I discovered a lot of silence in the center. Kusturi Raj was there as a second lieutenant.
My first year.
He was in the training battalion as a second lieutenant. And I went there and said, what the hell's happened? He said, oh, there's big rioting and between the Marathas and the Sikhs and so on. So we got some law and order. So we went round and we fixed the whole thing. We said, there'll be absolute peace. And there was absolute peace. When Bhagat came, he was wild. And he lined us all up on parade and kept us lined all day, saying that, I want to know who is hit whom and why and what and what. Who led this rioting? Only one fellow came back. Came for one of the boys from boys battalion, senior boys. He said, मैंने पत्थर फेंका था उसका ये किया था बहुत गलती की. So Prem Bhagat took him, put him on the platform and says, एक आदमी आया है बोलने के लिए सारे दिन में ये एक ही दिल वाला आदमी है सच बोलता है बाकी तुम सब झूठे हो. Anyway, we settled all that and we got it sorted out. And Bombay's happened since then. It's changed a great deal. I mean, that parade ground was all soft earth, muddy, dusty. It's all paved. Gates have come up, buildings have come up, barracks have come up. It's changed totally. The training battalion is where the depot battalion is now. Now the training battalion has moved towards Tindi. During the war, they had produced three training battalions. Two forward at Tindi and one was at the center. And there was this road going through the middle of Bombay Sappers compound. And the depot battalion was the other side where they had the depot battalion guard from. And this side was the training battalion. All that has changed now. We have made a bypass. They wanted that road which belonged to us. But the cantonment got hold of many, many years later. Sanjeev Talwar. Sanjeev's father was the first cadet from Bombay Sappers, from the IMA, from Second Course IMA, to join the Bombay Sappers. And he came to the center, did a little bit of did his field engineering training, did, went off to JNK, it was 1948. And he went through the battle areas there and did everything. And when he came back to do his, what they call the degree course, which is much shorter than now, then, when they finished, they posted him out, not back to 411, because he never had a chance to jump. Because all parachuting training had stopped in 48 and 49. It started again in 1950 when the 48 battle had settled down. And when they posted him out, they sent him to another unit. Now, I was nowhere near. I was a paratrooper from before partition. And I'd never served in the Bombay Sappers parachute unit. But I was one of the senior Indian paratroopers, meaning the rank was junior, but one of the oldest paratroopers there. I wrote a letter straight to the ENC branch saying, how could you do this? The first ever cadet from the Indian Military Academy after independence, who was in 411 parachute unit, volunteered for it, served in battle in JNK, did his share there, did his degree course, and now you don't send him back to 411. And I got the answer back verbally, saying, shut up and keep your bloody mouth shut, you're not. Such are the beautiful engineers.
So you have been engineering chief. And you were a loved engineering chief.
That I don't know, but still.
We love you, sir. We still love you. For many qualities which you have. As a paratrooper, as a Bombay Sapper, I would like to know some stories about that time.
Well, I never expected to become engineer chief, and I had no such ambition. I had no ambitions at all. I only wanted to keep on parachuting. And when I left 411, they wouldn't let us parachute. But then they found the volunteers and not performing so well. I did some skydiving with an engineer. What's his name? It became EMC later on. He was a glider pilot also. And
Ranjan Goswami.
He was a major then.
Yes.
And I was a retired lieutenant general, yes, working for Hawkins Cookers. But they allowed us to jump, so I went and did some skydiving with him.
Yes.
Then they allowed the retired people to jump. So, jump with them. In fact, I've been jumping as engineer in chief earlier.
Yes.
Because they said not enough and did some jumps with Stan Barrett, who's a Bengal sapper, also a paratrooper.
Yes. Yes.
He jumped after a gap of nearly 30 years. In fact, my last day in the army was spent parachuting with 411 in Agra rather than at Delhi. Prikshit Puri took over. I said, come earlier, 2 days before retirement, in 31st October 1981. 2 days earlier, I went to Agra. And on 30th October, did some jumps with engineers. Then did some jumps with the para brigade. And on Sunday morning, retired, came back to Delhi. In the same staff car, but this time with Stan Barrett's name. He was the Major General serving. I was a Lieutenant General retired, not authorized the car. Such is life. Later on, they asked the retired people to jump also. They jump very regularly all over the place. You name it, Sarsawa, Khalagvasla, Diggy, but a lot of jumps at Diggy. And had a lot of fun till I was about 86. Now, I'm not one of those foolish jumpers who goes across and just jumps. I only see the doc first. And the Air Force, it was an Air Force doctor who left the Air Force 20 years ago at Moolchand Hospital. Yeah, across. Yeah. So I went across to him and said, have a look. And he said, yes, yes, you can go and do it, but be a little careful. I said, well, what's happened? He said, you got old. I was 86, you see. He said, your legs are not what they used to be. I said, you mean there's a chance of damage there? He said, of course there is. As you go older, your bones go weaker. I said, yeah, I'm stopping. He said, don't have to, but be more careful. I said, yeah, I've been jumping for fun. I've done about 250 jumps and more, sir, just for fun. Why the hell should I risk my neck now? So I stopped. This is the whole joke. Why do you want to jump to show off to somebody else? It's the greatest fun going.
I agree, sir. One more point, sir,
which comes to my mind. You have such a long span, sir, as a sapper in your post superannuation period. What is one particular incident which flashes in your mind time and again?
This
took place in 1946 in the northeast corner of Indonesia. They keep twisting the name. They used to be called Surabaya in those days, maybe Surabaya or something like that now. It was the second largest town in Indonesia. And 46, the Japanese prisoners had come out by themselves. But Sukarno had taken over and the Dutch couldn't get back. But the British had gone there to collect the prisoners. And they were trying to help the Dutch, but they stopped very fast because the British regiment had stopped it. So I was there, and we were working, and we were trying to help keep the peace, and we Indians sent word around to all the Indonesians, we are not here to rescue this place for the Dutch or the British or anyone, but the British rule India, and we are their army. So we have to obey orders, so we don't want to fight you. So whenever something mild happens, because there are many Indonesians who were out of control and not obeying Sukarno, who said, go slow, go slow. So we had battles in places, we had casualties, we had this and that. So one day a few bridges got blown up, and I was constructing this bridge with my Pathans, when in the village close by, a huge crowd of about 20, 30 people came up running and shouting, very angry, wild tempers. So I was standing on the bridge and said, lift your hair. And there was a lance knight, Sirajuddin, big 6 foot fellow Pathan, who'd, tribal Pathan, who'd adopted me as his, sapko dekhenge. The only two Indians out of 27 engineer officers at that time, and 5 day engineers, and I was the junior boss. So I said, he said, sahab, ye kehte koi gaon mein ghus gaya, auraton ke piche ja raha hai. So here was I, faced bullets in 1942 from police, quit India movements. Went through the tail end of the war. And a Britisher tells me, when are you taking over this shitty country? In 44, in the jungle, when we were both in a miserable state. So I laughed. But anyway, that's something else. I said, yeah, wow, gussa chadha. Now, when gussa chadha hai, your mind goes out of control. So, I had a 38 pistol in my thing. I got a job. I ran into the village with these people, all very angry, around me. And this, I must have taken about 15, 20 steps. And I'll make shout behind me from Sarajwadi, Aapmi Marera, Sanubi Marwaira. And before I knew what happened, he put two light machine guns on the left side, one light machine gun on the right side, one light machine gun right at the bridge side. We had four platoons in the engineers those days. I think we still have, I'm not sure. And he came behind me with a stem gun and with half a dozen people. We barged into the village and I started thinking. I said, my God, you bastard. This Lance Nayak has done what you should have done to get safety for all of us. You never know, it's a trap.
Yes.
Some Indonesians were trying to trap us. So we barged into this village and we went inside and there was a hut there and this Sardar came out, artillery Sardar driver. He's standing on the veranda and he says, took two steps down and I said, kya karai da? Kata sab murgi khareedne aaya tha. Before I could say a word, this Sarajuddin had fired two bullets in the ground, two bullets in the air.